Thank you for joining me on Spotlight on Success. Today, I have a very, very special guest with me. Guys, he's a ladies' man, but not like you think. It's celebrity hairstylist Chuck Capel. Thanks, Chuck, for joining me today.
Welcome.
Look, so we're just going to jump right in it. You are an international educator. You travel all over the country. You're well sought after. I mean, you just do it well in a field that's dominated by women. You have dominated this field of hairstyling, and you just do it all. Tell me, how do you stay abreast of the trends when everything is ever changing in the hair industry?
Well, you know, in this business, you know, you have to be a trendsetter.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so you don't, sometimes you don't always go for the trend. You have to create the trend, you know. And you know, with all my years of training, you know, I use that as a catalyst, you know, as a basis to continue what I do and to try to stay afloat and stay on top of my craft by, you know, inventing the trend most of the time.
Okay. And you are an inventor because, listen, I have known you for a long time. Love you. You're my heart. And you have, you're the owner, president of Complexion Semi-Permanent Colors. You have 33 years in this business, and you're being shy because you're awesome. I mean, you are, you have on here United Kingdom, South Africa. You also created the curriculum for South Africa. So you are doing things way beyond. You are, you train stylists all around the world. So you are being shy. What's your inspiration?
Well, my inspiration is, I would say my inspiration is just, you know, just trying to create other leaders,
mm-hmm.
you know, create, you know, other champions in the industry, in the business, you know. A very prosperous religious leader once said that, you know, your legacy and your success, it's not about what you accomplish, it's what you leave when you're gone.
Wow.
And he said that if your success dies when you die, then you have nothing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so I want to make sure that, you know, when I'm gone or when I retire, that what I leave and what I left behind can endure, you
mm-hmm.
know, have, you know, can persevere. So I just try to stay motivated by trying to elevate more people. And you know, people think sometimes that, you know, it's all about acclimations, you know,
mm-hmm.
you know, what you can acquire, you know, but, you know, stuff dies, stuff rusts.
That's right.
You know, but
that's right.
I want to be able to give something to people where they can take on it and that can be my legacy, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You have living legacies, you have, you know, legacies that's going on, but my legacy has always been while I'm here and while I'm gone that, you know, what I do can prevail.
Okay, and so your definition of success, you know, I understand the legacy. That's great. That is wonderful. That's why you're a creator and you're an innovator. So tell me, what is your definition of success? Because, you know, Spotlight on Success is about walking in success and having a God-ordained purpose. And we're giving back through inspiration. We're trying to get purpose and we're trying to help people to walk in their God-ordained purposes. So for you, you know, people think success is about accolades and about having things. For you personally, what does success look like to you, and what is your definition of success? Because I think you're walking in very high success right now because you accomplished so much, I mean, out of the norm that other hairdressers don't do.
Well, you know, when I look at success, you know, every time I think I've accomplished something
mm-hmm.
or accomplished a goal, then, you know, it's always a rush. It's always that adrenaline, you know, that you get from trying to accomplish something. And then when you reach it, you know, when I reach it, I feel like, okay, well, now what's next? You know, so my explanation of success is a lot like what I've heard some of your other people on Spotlight Success say. It's not a destination, it's a journey.
Right.
You know, it's not something that you try to, a plateau that you try to reach. Because if that's what it is, once you reach it, then what are you gonna do then?
Mm.
You know, so you have to keep striving, you have to keep going. You just try to have to keep trying to create more stuff and then, you know, make more things possible, more things available for other people. So my understanding of success, or my explanation or definition of success, is always striving, you know, always trying to be the best. And Just stay one step ahead of the crowd.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now you have to admit that you're a different type of guy, because you're different with how you do hair and how you handle hair. Your niche is hair coloring and cutting. And you used to take me on some of those hair shows, you know, back in the day. But then when you got out there, he forgot all about me, y'all. So he stopped cutting and using me. But anyway, we're going to get back to that. But your journey is a little bit different. How does it feel to be different but to be good at being different? Because you don't do a lot of the very hard hairstyles and rough stuff. You take care of the hair. Your thing is healthy hair. And you have the creative color lines. And so how does it feel to be Chuck and to be different? Because there are a lot of women out there that would love to travel around the world, and men, and be sought out by stylists like you, but you're a very humble man. What does that different feel like? And how did you become different in such a vast, you know, arena? Because hair is on every corner almost, it looked like. And in basement, in houses, so.
Well, I always say that I'm the black sheep of the industry.
Yeah.
You know, because I do stand out, mm-hmm. and I do stick to, you know, my values and my morals and my ethics in this industry. And I don't always go along with the flow. You know, somebody told me recently that, you know, eagles fly by themselves, you know, and you know, chickens in a group, you know, whatever. Mm-hmm. But you know, I try to do things different. I'm a very public person when it comes to my business, but anybody who knows me knows that I'm very private, mm-hmm. outside of that, you know. So, and the way I stay humble is because I had a humble beginning, you know. And I revert back to something in the Bible that we talk about in the book of James. It says, you know, consider it pure joy when you go through trials and many tribulations.
Okay.
You know, because it creates perseverance, you know. And so, I have a story that most people don't know, you know. You can be at the top of your game out in the public and people see you and put you on a pedestal. But, you know, I've been out there before and been, you know, in the spotlight, taking pictures, autographing my books, and broke,
mm-hmm.
you know, and have gone through that and come back. And people never know that, you know, because I am a very private person. Mm-hmm. And also because, getting back to that scripture I just quoted, mm-hmm. because, you know, I've had many hurdles and obstacles to overcome, some created by myself and some created by other people, haters and you know, betrayal, mm-hmm. you know. And I always call myself the black sheep because, you know, I'm often sought after, but nobody seeks me, if that makes sense. You know,
yeah,
I'm often
does.
Sought after, but, you know, people tend to look at you and they smile at you and they laugh at you, you know, laugh with you, but they don't always want to collaborate with you, you know. So, and, you know, at one point in my career, I took that as an offense and it made me feel some kind of way, mm-hmm. you know. But now, you know, I look at it as a stepping stone, because I feel like, you know, there is a reason why people don't collaborate,
mm-hmm.
is because, you know, and then whatever the reason is, you know, when you're in the public in this industry, you can't say everything.
Okay.
You know. So, you know, I mean, in social media and stuff like that, you know, you have to watch what you say, because when you are in the public's eye, you can't say everything. Mm-hmm. But I have a lot of feelings, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. But again, I am very private, so, you know, I try to stay that way. And I started out training with the best in the industry. Olive Lee Benson out of Boston, Massachusetts, who's passed on, and she passed away about 7-8 years ago,
mm-hmm.
and she was the authority on hair care.
Wow.
And she was, you know, worldwide, and so I trained on her extensively, and that's where I got my basis. And so I pretty much follow her footsteps, and you know, and I stay true to hair care.
Okay.
So when you say I'm different from everybody else, I go with the trend, but I don't do trend if it means I have to compromise the hair care.
Okay, good. Spotlight on success, my viewer spotlighters. We haven't had anybody to be so open about being out there and then being broke at the same time and coming back from that. Now, we have a lot of people who talk about where they've been and they see the good side. But the reason that we do this show, we want people to see both sides so they can prevail and go towards their dreams and know with God, all things are possible. And you are a living example. I know your background. I know who you are. And this guy is a good-hearted man and you're a hard worker. So you telling your story, that brings me back around to being an author. So you're, you know, jack of all trades, like they say. Not only do you do hair, but you have three books, right?
Yeah.
Okay, and so those books focus around what? Hair coloring, hair cutting?
Well, mostly hair color.
Okay.
You know, I'm considering doing one on hair cutting, mm-hmm. but that's a strategic type of work.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, and in reference to what you said about my story, you know, I feel like, you know, it's a lot of time. It's the troubles you go through and the trials and the obstacles and hurdles that you go through that make you who you are.
Yeah.
That determines, you know, how you act. So that's pretty much, you know, my ID. That's how you know, I am the way that I am, because I know how hard it is to stay on top, you know. And you know, again, you know, when you're in the public eye, you know, you can't portray everything. And so, you know, there has been times where, you know, I mean, I've been, you know, I mean, I've acquired and accomplished a lot of things in my career.
Yes,
you know,
I
worked all over the world, you know, in foreign countries, and you know, written books and stuff like that. But you know, I've been to the mountaintop,
mm-hmm.
and I've also been to the valley. You know, so and that valley is what puts you in a reality check. You know, it gives you a different perspective, and it makes you value stuff more. You know, when you're at the top, you take it for granted, you know, and then, you know, you can lose it really fast.
Mm.
And, you know, when you lose it, you know, then you become grounded. And so I've been there, you know, I've taken pictures and signed autographs and smiled in people's faces and looked like I'm the, you know, picture of extreme success.
Mm-hmm.
And at the same time, you know, financially broke,
mm-hmm.
you know, mm-hmm. Successfully powerful, successfully rich, but, you know, financially broke,
wow.
and, you know, and so it puts you in perspective. And but nobody knows that but my immediate family, you
okay.
know, nobody in the industry knows, you know, the hardships that I've, you know, survived, you know, because I don't, again, I'm a very private person. I don't put that out in the public, you know. You know, my wife knows it. My kid knows it. My kids don't even know it, you know, but my wife knows it. You know, maybe one or two individuals who are close to me in the industry, like my managers and stuff like that, but nobody really knows what you go through. And so people tend to pounce on that when they know that,
mm-hmm.
you know. When people know that you've gone through some things or you are going through some things, they use that as leverage. So I stay private, you know, because my private life really isn't anybody else's business anyway, mm-hmm. you know. So I'm there for the hair industry and what I do in the business.
Okay, with all that being said, do you feel like you're walking in purpose? Because what I hear is that people got to know that if it's anything worth having, even walking in God-ordained purposes, you're going to suffer sometimes. You're going to have to make some sacrifices. And to be where you're at as a celebrity hairstylist, it's not always going to be easy. That's what people look at. They see the good, but they don't consider the bad. And that's what makes people give up and quit. So with all that you have said, I'm going to bring it back to you and ask you, the sacrifices, the hurdles, the things, being in the valley, going to the mountaintop, and being at the mountaintop now, do you feel like that this is your purpose?
Oh yeah, most definitely I feel like, you know, that's my purpose, because I feel like, you know, sometimes we go through things in life where there are no explanations. You know, I've had some things happen to me in my career that, you know, it couldn't have been anything else but God. You know, I don't speak a lot about that, you know, in public, you know, because people tend to shy away from your frown if you go too religious on them, you know. But I mean, you know, I was always told that, you know, if God is, if you say it, if you deny me, I would deny you, you know. But I mean, there's been so many things that happened to me that there was no other explanation but God, you
mm-hmm.
know. You know, some things I've done in this industry, I was chosen.
That's
you know,
right.
And I was, you know, my stint in Africa, you know, a lot of people don't have the privilege, the opportunity to frequent Africa on more than one occasion, you know, and some things just come about, some things happen, and I feel like I'm walking in destiny, because I feel like everything that's happening to me that has happened was predestined, you know, and this was my lot in life, and this is the path I was supposed to go in. You know, I think everything happened for that reason. And because, I mean, I went to the top early,
mm-hmm.
quick.
Yeah.
You know, when I got in this industry, you know, I was sort of like catapulted to the top quick, you know, and it was mind blowing. You know, it was a major thing for me. And I was at an age where I was too young to really respect it. You know, when I got into this industry, I was 20 years old. I was the youngest. I was the youngest instructor in the state of Virginia at the time that I was instructor, when I was back in the late 80s. So, and I went to the top, and I went to the top fast. So I started to move fast. And sometimes when you move too fast, you know, you run across problems, and that's what happened to me, you know. And I've had more than one occasion where I went to the mountaintop and came back to the valley again. So I've been there frequently. I know what it feels like, I know what it looks like. And it makes you wiser, and it helps you to not go that direction again.
Okay, so now let me ask you this. Anywhere in that you know, that mountaintop, you see taking me to Africa with you anytime soon? Yeah, I just want to ask them that, guys. So
yeah, well, my family don't want me to go back to Africa no more.
Oh, well,
you know, with all the terrorism stuff, they don't want me to go anywhere out of the country.
Okay, well, we family, so we're gonna talk about that, because I want to go to Africa.
Yeah.
Okay, so anyway, I think that you look good, what you do, you know, celebrity hairstyles. I see you in magazines. Chuck Capel is a well-known name in the industry. So you spoke about that, kind of said about having a legacy. Where do you go from there? Because you're obviously on the mountaintop.
Well, it's you know, when you get to the mountaintop, that's when the work begins, because you got to stay there, you know. You know, it's not easy. It's not always as hard getting there. The real task is staying there, you know. And so, you know, and as we grow and as I grow, you know, I'm constantly, you know, frequently, you know, coming up with more, you know, avenues and more things to do in this industry, more things that I have always thought about doing. And so we take them in steps. And so, you know, I just try to, you know, continue to do those things and you know, create more avenues and create more opportunities for myself as well as other people. You know, I have some things, I always say, never get satisfied.
Oh, wow. You know,
if you get satisfied, then you stop progressing, you know. So I never get satisfied. You know, I eat, drink, and sleep this business.
Wow.
You know, when most people are out playing, I'm working. You know, when most people are out, you know, clubbing, I'm working. When people are, you know, out dining and eating, I'm working. You know, when most people are asleep, I'm working. You know, it's the last thing out of my mind before I go to sleep. It's the first thing I pop up when I get up in the morning. So I'm always thinking about what I can do next and what I can make better and how I can make what I do better. And you know, and so it's not just a job with me. You know, it's a way of life, you know, and it's part of what I do.
The nuggets that Chuck is sharing with us about when you get to the mountaintop, you have to stay there. You have to eat and live and breathe that thing. But it's not a burden when it's your purpose, right? This is where you find your joy. And that's why I believe that you can be successful when you're walking in purpose, because you find your joy. You enjoy doing what you do, right?
Yeah.
Okay. And not only that, I noticed that you're successful with it. You're continuously staying with it. You go above and beyond, because you have a training camp and you do clientele everywhere. You do classes. You just got from California, where you have a demand for a couple of more classes. So you're on this thing to stay, it look like. How many more years you got in you?
Well, you know, I mean, you don't look at it as a job. So when you look at it as part of life and something you enjoy doing, you just do it until you get tired, you know what I mean? It's almost like, you know, your work is your hobby, you know? And so I still got a lot of good years in me, and I don't see myself stopping anytime soon. I reinvented some things, you know.
Okay.
I restructured some things, and you know, sometimes you go full circle. You know, I came out of the salon years ago, full-time in the salon, part-time for over almost 15 years now.
Okay.
And now sometimes I find myself wanting to go back into the salon now, you know. It's almost like it's come full circle. But I don't get tired of, I don't think I'll ever get tired of, you know, helping people grow and teaching, training people. And I think that, you know, I always say that hair styling and hair is my talent, but teaching is my gift.
Okay.
You know, talent is something you acquire, something you have an agility and ability to do, but your gift comes from God. You know, I think that was my purpose and my gift, because I was forced into it, not necessarily forced, but, you know, kind of coerced into going into teaching when I was 21 years old. And that was the farthest thing from my mind. Mm-hmm. And as I look back on it now, that was my destiny, because now I'd rather be in a classroom in front of 300, 400 people and in the salon working.
Amazing.
Because that's, you know, that's who I'm supposed to be, you know. You know, it was all predestined. God knew where I was supposed to be, you know. I didn't know.
I believe it.
And so, you know, you never really get tired of that, you know. The traveling is good. I've always enjoyed traveling. Sometimes it gets tiresome. But, you know, if anything is worth having, it's worth working for. Nothing's going to be easy.
Okay.
You know, so I don't expect to be, you know, just a bed of roses. But, you know, so that's basically, you know, where I am with that. You know, it's not like a job. It's almost like a hobby.
Okay. Now, I'm not going to hold you too much longer because I have one or two more questions. You created Voice Command. Is that correct?
Yeah.
What is Voice Command?
Well, Voice Command is a teaching method that I feel has put me on the cutting edge and it puts me above everybody else. I have a unique way of training and teaching, and nobody else teaches that way. And I take pride in what I do. There are other educators out there who are excellent at what they do, but you got a lot of. I always use this as a paraphrase. I say you have a lot of Snoop Dogs and people like that, you know, like the Chris Browns, and then, mm-hmm. then you got the Frankie Beverly's, and
yeah.
you know, I consider myself the Frankie Beverly industry because I do things my way. I stick to what I do. I never change it. I just make it better. Mm-hmm. And so I developed this teaching method years ago, and it came to me, you know, that when we do hands-on training in this industry, it's done a traditional way. Mm-hmm. And, you know, stylists go into a training center or a trade show, and they take these classes, and the instructor, the educator, you know, gives them three or four different cuts to do. He illustrates those cuts, and then they come behind him and then duplicate those cuts. Mm-hmm. Well, I determined that that's more of a visual type thing, you know, as a photogenic memory type thing. You know, if you sit there and watch somebody do something, if you're creative enough, you can copy and duplicate that. And it doesn't allow you to really grow a build.
Okay.
So with the voice command technique is what it is. So instead of doing those three or four cuts like the other people do, I may do four or five or six, seven, eight cuts, not in completion. You know, we might do a bob, for example, but we don't do the entire bob. I might do one panel or the mannequin heads, and on another panel I do another cut, and another panel I do another cut, and I separate the head in four panels and do four separate cuts. Then I take those four separate cuts and turn them into something else.
Oh, okay.
So basically what I do is teach them technique, every technique that they're going to need in order to accomplish what they want to accomplish. And I use the terminology as I go along. So then when we get to the part where they come in and actually do the physical part, I just call out the technique, you know. So I said, on this panel right here, we're going to do this particular technique right here. Mm-hmm. I want you to section your hair into a diagonal part with a 45-degree angle with a perpendicular distribution and cut it diagonal forward.
Wow, okay.
And so people who don't know what I'm talking about, that's foreign language.
Yeah.
So because they saw me train them in the first 2 hours, they cut based on what I say. And at no time do they understand what kind of cut they're going to do because I haven't told them. Mm-hmm. I don't want them to know. I want them to cut based on the technique. So what this does, it allows them to cut hair now from their knowledge and what they know as opposed to what they see. And what that does, it allows them to retain information.
Mm.
See, a lot of stylists go into trainings and they do techniques and they do things. They color hair, they cut hair, and they go back to the salon and they don't know they don't retain the information. It escapes them once they get out of class. But once you teach it to them and teach it to them in terminology, theory, and principle, and allow them and cause them and demand for them to speak it and understand it, then they can cut based on principle, and then they can cut based on theory. And my cutting techniques are based on architecture principles.
Wow,
you know, I received that from a man named Leo Passage out of Chicago. He's passed also. He's from a foreign country, out of the country, but he has a world headquarters in Chicago called Pivot Point International, and I used to go out there and do 5-day multicultural classes for him periodically, and he introduced me to what we call the Bauhaus theory, and it's cutting hair using architectural principles.
Wow.
So that's what the voice command thing is.
Okay, wonderful. Yeah. See, that's something that I would not have known, and a lot of people out here would not have known. So obviously, you're the guy to come to. If you need any training, if you need some private lessons, if you need Chuck to help you out to be the best you can be. This is the guy, but you got to catch him because you're constantly traveling. You're going back to California soon, right?
Yeah, I'm going to California soon. Actually, it's not until July, but okay. I'm heading to Houston in a couple of weeks, and then we go from there to Orlando for the largest trade show in the country every June called the Premier Orlando Beauty Show, and then from there we go back to Florida and back to Houston again. Then I go to California.
Wow, a lot of traveling. Okay, so that means you're a busy guy. We're not going to hold you too much longer. But before we go, I would like for you to, you know, you've shared some of your testimony. You've told us what success looked like, legacy looked like. You know, what does it feel like to be celebrity Chuck Capel? And what can you tell these people out here, my spotlighters, that's intrigued to do something better, to walk in purpose, and even those who would look at this and say, I want to be a black sheep. I want to be different.
Well, you know, that's nice that you asked me that, because that's a question that I don't get asked much.
Okay.
But, you know, I don't know what it feels like yet, because, okay. You know, I've often sat back and watched others and say, man, I want to be like that person. Mm. When I trained under Olive, I said, I want to be like her, you know, because she's world-renowned and people know her. People call her from all over the country to train. You know, people say they want to take pictures, they want to sign autographs, you know, and all that kind of thing. And I said, I want to be like that. I've seen other people in the industry, I want to be like them. And you know, and now I, in retrospect, I look back and all the things that I said I wanted to do and wanted to be like, I'm in the midst of it right now. Mm-hmm. But now that I've gotten to that point, you know, it feels different. And I think that's what causes me to stay humble, because I don't let it go to my head. Mm-hmm. And I don't get cocky behind it, you know, even though I've been labeled cocky.
Wow, you know, I can't see that.
I've been labeled cocky. I've been labeled mean in the industry. People call me mean all the time. They call me cocky, you know, and that's one of the main reasons why I have my manager right now, who's out in Houston, Texas, who is my publicist, who really speaks for me, because people prefer to relate to her as opposed to relating to me. Mm-hmm. But, you know, when I find myself now in the moment and doing things that I've always said I wanted to do, but now that I've gotten to that moment, you know, it's almost like it's surreal. It don't really feel real, but you know, I know it's real, but you know, and I don't want it, and I don't want it to be to a point where it becomes numbing and it makes me lose, you know, perspective, you know, but it's kind of hard to explain how it feels, you know what I mean? You know, I put it this way, I worked hard to get it.
I worked hard to get there,
and it's always a work in progress. It's always been a work in progress. It's always continual. And, you know, so when you get there, you know, it's just, so when I have people now who do the same thing to me. People call me from all over the country. You know, I have a lady I'm training this weekend that's coming in from Anchorage, Alaska.
Okay.
You know, she's coming in, flying in for 2 days to train with me. And so people call me. People want autographs and books and stuff like that. And people want, you know, to hire you for salon training and stuff like that from all over. And I find myself in the middle of that, but you know, I try to keep it in perspective, you know, because just as sure as you can get it, you can lose it.
That's right.
And so, you know, it's a different type. It's kind of hard to explain. It's a different type thing.
Great to wrap this up, but we're going to talk some more off of camera about, you know, my hair. You may want to cut me up in color and take me with you, you know, because if you cut it, I can get it back next week, ladies. You know that. So, tell me, last question. This is in your blood, right?
Yeah, this is my blood. My mom has been a hairdresser for probably close to 50 years.
Yeah,
and her sister is a licensed cosmetologist. And you know, it's you know, I started out when I was 16 years old, cutting my little cousin's hair in my mom's salon on the weekend just for a couple of dollars. You know, mm-hmm. cut a haircut for $2. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And you know, so that's how it basically started, you know. And when I came out of high school, you know, I tried to go to college, and when I got there, I realized that, you know, I wanted something different, you know. And so I did that, you know. So my mom said, why don't you go to school to do barbering? And I said, I don't think I just want to do barbering. I think I want to do more than that. Mm-hmm. I want to do women's hair. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when I got into the business, you know, and the moment I got into it, the director of the school wanted me to be a teacher. And I don't know why he wanted me to be a teacher, but obviously he saw something in me that I didn't see. And I always pay homage to him, every time I get a chance to talk about it, because if it had not been for him, you know, everybody played an intricate part. Mm-hmm. My mom played the initial part because, you know, from her influence, she got me into the business. The director at the school played a major part in me becoming who I am right now, teacher, because he coerced me into being an instructor. Olive had the major impact on me because until I trained with her, it wasn't until her that I became comfortable on stage. You know, before I met her, I did platform work for about 8 years. I would always get on the stage at a major show, and I had to work a half an hour, 30 minutes to break the ice, to get the nervousness out, the jitteriness. And once I got that 30 minutes past me, then I could be on stage all day. Until I started training with her, you know, getting on stage and getting in front of a crowd was like drinking water. So it's like commonplace me now. So I don't rehearse. I don't teach from a script, you know. Whereas in the beginning, I used to get to the hotel, rehearse my script about half an hour in front of a mirror. Now when I rehearse, my way of rehearsing now is I get to the hotel, unpack, call room service, get something to eat, and try to find something on TV that's funny. That's how I relax. I don't think about the job until I walk into the trade show floor that morning, and then it's showtime.
Okay. And I've seen some pictures out there, so you have quite a crowd too.
Yeah,
that's a wonderful thing. Okay, my spotlighters, that's our time, but we have Chuck Caper, we have a celebrity hairstylist, we have a author, we have a innovator, we have a creator, we have it all wrapped up in one, and he is on the mountaintop. We're gonna pray that he stay there. I wish you the best of luck. I got your back. Whatever you need, a model, you need somebody to jump in, I'm here, you know. So much love to him. I am a little biased, but look, he's worked hard for where he's at. He said it, he's doing it on his own and looking good. I love being a black sheep. I thought I was the only black sheep in the family, but I'm gonna catch up to him. The next thing we're going to do is be black sheep. Okay, so thank you so much for joining me. Thank you, Spotlighters on Success. This is Spotlight on Success. And once again, walk in your purpose.